阮家姐袂歹看吼。
AI 教父黄仁勋台大开讲谈 AI 科技，中英台三声道切换，
从25公里提高到2公里。
国语讲的标准吗？
原来影片中的声音并非黄仁勋本人，而是由 AI 替他来读稿。但他要介绍这项野心勃勃的计划，就是以 AI 模拟地球，能够预测未来气候。
This is Earth 2. The idea that we would create a digital twin of the Earth, that we would go and simulate the Earth, so that we could predict the future of our planet.
若利用 AI 创建全球气候虚拟模型，可以精准预测天气的巨大变化，气象署也能借此观测台风青苔，可以模拟范围突破性的达到2公里。
Specialized processor can take something that takes a great deal of time and accelerate it down to something that is incredibly fast.
韩华与台湾携手合作，创造全台 AI 基础建设。
Taiwan is the home.Of our treasured partners. This is in fact where everything NVIDIA does begins. Our partners and ourselves take it to the world.
黄仁勋抛出数位人类新愿景，在全球掀起一股 AI 旋风。TVBS 新闻综合报道。
She's the fruit lady, and it's in the middle of the middle between the two. Go find her, okay? She.做赞嘞，做赞嘞，都喝假。
同一件黑色皮外套 ，AI 教父黄仁勋老台语大赞夜市水果，时隔一年再度站上台大讲台。不过主题明明是 AI 科技，怎么谈到夜市话题？
圆环，讲对吗？圆环，去吃蚵仔煎。And I love going. And one day.My face, you guys might see that I have a large scar on my face. My face was cut because somebody was washing their knife.
看来黄仁勋对台湾夜市真的爱，而台大体育馆开讲，满满科技感的蓝色灯光，现场超过5000人，而为了挤进会场。粉丝冒着雨撑伞在台大体育馆排队安检。演讲晚间7点正式开始，不过早在下午4点多，场外就已经涌现大批民众，一路排到路口。粉丝得提前报名并取得核准，而黄仁勋的妻小当然也没缺席。
Are you excited about it?
Oh yes, very much so. He's worked very hard, so is the whole team.
Is he nervous?
No.Excited.
为了这场演说，黄仁勋可是不敢马虎，提前彩排练习。
We have a rehearsal yesterday.
I think they did for a little bit. Yes.
So you are so proud of him, right?
Oh yes, very much so.
不止民众为之疯狂，这场演讲也吸引数百名媒体。AI 浪潮再起，人人都想亲眼见识皇室魅力。TVBS 新闻综合报道。
This is Earth 2.The idea that we would create a digital twin of the Earth, that we would go and simulate the Earth so that we could predict the future of our planet to better avert disasters or better understand the impact of climate change.
CoreDiff 是 NVIDIA 的生成式 AI 模型，它在 WRF 数值模拟的基础上训练而成，能够以12倍更高的解析度生成天气模式，从25公里提高到2公里。
我的国语讲的标准吗？The truth is.That was a Jensen AI. That was not me. I wrote it, but an AI, Jensen AI, had to say it. 我的国语不够好。That is a miracle. That is a miracle indeed.
Taiwan is the home of our treasured partners. This is in fact.Where everything NVIDIA does begins, our partners and ourselves take it to the world. Taiwan and our partnership has created the world's AI infrastructure.
The central processing unit, the performance scaling has slowed tremendously. And yet, the amount of computation we have to do is still doubling very quickly, exponentially. By adding the GPU to the CPU, the specialized processor can take something that takes a great deal of time and accelerate it down to something that is incredibly fast. And because the two processors can work side by side, they're both autonomous and they're both separate, independent that is, we can accelerate what used to take 100 units of time down to 1 unit of time.
观众朋友们，今天晚上呢，就是辉达执行长黄仁勋在台大开讲。那么可以看到，现在现场中呢，黄仁勋已经到了台上来分享 AI 产业链的一些新的应用，一起来听他的访问。
Taiwan is the home of our treasured partners. This is in fact where everything NVIDIA does begins. Our partners and ourselves take it to the world.Taiwan and our partnership has created the world's AI infrastructure.
问到这个太狂了。The central processing unit, the performance scaling has slowed tremendously. And yet, the amount of computation we have to do is still doubling very quickly, exponentially.
我们可以听到黄仁勋是说明 AI 新的应用之外呢，也有来说到了跟台湾的合作伙伴的这个关系是越来越密切了。以上是我们掌握到最新消息，稍后有更多的资讯再为您掌握了。演讲尾声，看到这幕，所有人都忍不住直呼好感动。黄仁勋6月2号台大开讲，背景秀出台湾地图和台厂供应链，显见对台湾的重视。演讲这天也有很多大咖到场相挺。
黄仁勋很精彩，一直很精彩。
广达董事长林百里从黄仁勋来台，两人已经连续见了好多天，演讲这天当然没缺席。
好期待今天听到什么样的内容，
待会听就知道。
鸿海董事长刘扬伟早早就到场，双手比赞，看得出愉悦心情。
我们希望今天听到什么样的内容。那还蛮期待的，
很期待。
华硕董事长施崇棠快步进入会场，还是不忘喊出“期待”两字。黄仁勋演讲大咖齐聚，场内也很热闹。美超微执行长梁建厚同样现身，大佬们早早就到场，看看第一排座位，包含威盛董事长陈文琪、富邦集团董事长蔡明忠、伟创董事长林宪明、广达副董梁次正、经济部长郭智辉，统统出席。
一定要来的，
真的？怎么说
的？啊，没有啊，这个很重要啊，是业界最大的事情。
另外还有 HTC 董事长王雪红、云达总经理杨其令以及光宝科总经理邱森斌，统统都到场了。大咖们齐聚听黄仁勋演讲，显见黄仁勋的好人缘更是另类盛会。台北新闻田嘉庆、庄启源、张慧贤小组台报道。
I was very surprised, you know, to see Morris Chang visiting Nine Markets in the late evening with you on TV. I say, hey, we hardly see him appear in public this way.
I think it was Morris's first time at the night market.
Really?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So how did you persuade him to go there?
He wanted to go. And we had oyster fried pancakes, and we had some shave ice, two great, great places. And he really enjoyed it. And mostly, we just enjoy each other's company.
Yes, this time we are so eagerly anticipating the establishment of the Taiwan R&D Center. Mm. As far as I know, it is the first of its kind, the first one in Asia. Mm. So would you like to share with us, what are the major factors that influence your decision on choosing Taiwan as a location for this very important center?
Well, we have a very long history in Taiwan. A long time ago, when I was young and NVIDIA was young, I came to Taiwan to seek partners to help us build our chips. Mm-hmm. And I was fortunate to have the support of TSMC.
Yes.
The packaging companies here in Taiwan, SPIL, many assembly companies here, Foxconn and ASUS and MSI and Quanta, and so many companies that helped us along the way. And so for over a quarter of a century now, over 25 years, wow. We've been doing...
That's a long history.
Very long history with companies in Taiwan. And so that's one reason. Another reason is the technology excellence.
This is the ecosystem here?
The ecosystem is unparalleled. Every aspect of building chips and building computers are located here. All the way down to the most minute complex connectors that connect very high-speed cables are manufactured here. And so the technology is excellent. The work ethic of the people here are incredible. And the companies have a spirit of partnership.
Yes.
that has really set Taiwan apart. And so I'm a huge fan of the company, the industry here, because it goes back with us for a very long time. Mm-hmm. And that's a good foundation. But Taiwan is the source of so much of our engineering. And we have hundreds of engineers here. And over the next 5 years, we're going to hire another 1,000 engineers here. And so we're going to set up our R&D center here, a major R&D center here. Mm-hmm. We're seeking for a large plot of land so that we can build a significant headquarters here.
Okay.
And so if anybody has some property they'd like to tell me about, you know, please let me know.
NVIDIA's stock price hits its new high recently, and so has your value. What does that mean to you?
Absolutely nothing. I was trying to think of a good answer, but I still wake up the same time. I still work the same way. I ate the same things. I love all the same things. I love all the same people. Nobody treat me any different. And I still have a mountain of work in front of me. And so nothing has changed.
I think it's everybody's curiosity. We've seen you really like to visit Taiwanese night markets. Mm. What attracts your interest so much in these night markets?
People are nice. They're working so hard. And they're trying to make a living. And it's nice to support them. When I was a child, I still have memories of going to the night market. And I enjoy the night market so much that I got my face cut at the night market.
Oh yeah, you mentioned yesterday.
I have a big scar on my face because of the night market. But I always have wonderful memories of the night market. And my parents used to take us a lot. And somehow it's always had a real fond place in my heart. And of course, the green mangoes are terrific. The fruit lady's fantastic. And so, you know, everybody works so hard. Everybody's so nice. And they're trying to make a living. It's kind of nice to be there to support them.
Gladly, the good old days, not just remain in memories.
Yeah, and I get to enjoy those memories. Yeah. Yeah.
I was very surprised, you know, to see Maurice Chang visiting night markets in the late evening with you on TV. I say, hey, we hardly see him appear in public this way.
I think it was Morris's first time at the night market.
Really?
Yeah.
So how did you persuade him to go there?
He wanted to go. And we had oyster fried pancakes, and we had some shave ice. Two great places, and he really enjoyed it. And mostly, we just enjoy each other's company.
Yes, this time we are so eagerly anticipating the establishment of the Taiwan R&D Center. Mm. As far as I know, it is the first of its kind, the first one in Asia. Mm. So would you like to share with us, what are the major factors that influence your decision on choosing Taiwan as a location for this very important center?
Well, we have a very long history in Taiwan. A long time ago, when I was young and NVIDIA was young, I came to Taiwan to seek partners to help us build our chips. Mm-hmm. And I was fortunate to have the support of TSMC.
Yes.
the packaging companies here in Taiwan, Spill, many assembly companies here, Foxconn and ASUS and MSI and Quanta, and so many companies that helped us along the way. And so for over a quarter of a century now, over 25 years, wow. We've been doing...
That's a long history.
Very long history with companies in Taiwan. And so that's one reason. Another reason is the technology excellence.
This is the ecosystem here?
The ecosystem is unparalleled. Every aspect of building chips and building computers are located here. All the way down to the most minute complex connectors that connect very high-speed cables are manufactured here. And so the technology is excellent. The work ethic of the people here are incredible. And the companies have a spirit of partnership,
yes,
that has really set Taiwan apart. And so I'm a huge fan of the company, the industry here, because it goes back with us for a very long time. Mm-hmm. And that's a good foundation. But Taiwan is the source of so much of our engineering. And we have hundreds of engineers here. And over the next 5 years, we're going to hire another 1,000 engineers here. And so we're going to set up our R&D center here, a major R&D center here. Mm-hmm. We're seeking for a large plot of land so that we can build a significant headquarters here.
Okay.
And so if anybody has some property they'd like to tell me about, you know, please let me know.
NVIDIA's stock price hits its new high recently. And so has your value. What does that mean to you?
Absolutely nothing. I was trying to think of a good answer, but I still wake up the same time. I still work the same way. I ate the same things. I love all the same things. I love all the same people. Nobody treat me any different. And I still have a mountain of work in front of me. And so nothing has changed.
I think it's everybody's curiosity. We've seen you really like to visit Taiwanese night markets. Mm. What attracts your interest so much in these night markets?
People are nice. They're working so hard. They're trying to make a living. And it's nice to support them. When I was a child, I still have memories of going to the night market. And I enjoy the night market so much that I got my face cut at the night market.
Oh yeah, you see, mentioned yesterday.
I have a big scar on my face because of the night market. But I always have wonderful memories of the night market. And my parents used to take us a lot. And somehow it's always had a real fond place in my heart. And of course, the green mangoes are terrific. The fruit lady's fantastic. And so, you know, everybody works so hard. Everybody's so nice. And they're trying to make a living. It's kind of nice to be there to support them.
Gladly, the good old days, not just remain in memories.
Yeah. And I get to enjoy those memories. Yeah. Yeah.
I was very surprised, you know, to see Maurice Chong visiting night markets in the late evening with you on TV. I say, hey, we hardly see him appear in public this way.
I think it was Morris's first time at the night market.
Really?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So how did you persuade him to go there?
He wanted to go. And we had oyster fried pancakes, and we had some shave ice, two great, great places. And he really enjoyed it. And mostly, we just enjoy each other's company.
那个黑衣男回答执行长黄仁勋29号晚上现身松山区一间私厨餐厅，同桌的还有广达董事长林百里、副董事长梁次正、台积电创办人张忠谋以及联发科董事长蔡明介、台湾大董事长蔡明宗等企业大佬。
Here, they want to see you, right here.
I can see you.
黄仁勋返台一举一动备受关注，外头一样有热情粉丝等着合照签名，后头紧跟着的是他的夫人，也一起共进晚餐。据了解，这场餐叙是由广达董事长林百里做东，早在傍晚5点多，广达就已经派随扈前来场刊，确保餐叙可以顺利进行。林百里最早现身在店内亲自招待贵宾。
晚安，晚安。
而据了解，大佬们聚餐的这间餐厅是最难订的台北三大私厨之一。这场号称是赵元宴的来宾，个个身价不凡。张忠谋身价36亿美元，林百里124亿美元 ，AI 教父黄仁勋1000亿美元，蔡明忠54亿美元，蔡明基也则是38亿美元。五个人的总身价超过台币4兆元。而其实回首今年1月，张忠谋、黄仁勋、林百里三个人也曾经到这间餐厅用餐，如今再次齐聚，虽然谈什么保密到家，不过可以一睹 AI 大佬的踪影，也让不少民众好兴奋。体育新闻陈明杰台北报道。
天忙碌的行程就是早上起来一早就要去菜场买菜啊，
超大只。
砂锅还砂锅？
砂锅。
这是早上6点半的滨江市场，已经是车水马龙，人声杂沓。周小琴总是亲自来采买所有洲际食铺该用到的食材，
因为你自己去买的话，才可以看到这个东西符不符合我的要求。因为你叫别人送，哎，不行啊。
周小琴带着我们在市场里东奔西跑，买完海鲜赶紧到猪肉摊，接着又奔去挑选龙虾和鲍鱼。没买完一样，就回到机车上，把食材挂在挂钩，还绑上后座。
挂钩有特制过？
对，不然完全承受不住。这个一下就没用了，这是特制，摸下面要摸起来非常的嫩，太老的有时候很粗。
周小琴的动作极快，像猎豹般瞄准猎物就下手，采买过程前后花不到2小时，而这只是一天的刚开始。
时间非常紧凑，因为中午有2桌的客人，一些功夫菜啊，比方说花雕原蹄啊，要炖4.5到5个小时之间，所以必须要赶回来。
周小琴坚持每道料理都是新鲜现做，不愿意提前做好再加热省时间，每天都在跟时间赛跑。率先出菜的腐皮卷和荠菜春卷都是现场包好再下锅。
我今年已经52岁了，我50岁之前的人生都是别人的，现在才属于我自己真正的人生。
20平大的店铺只有2张圆桌，洲际食铺就开在台北市商业区的巷弄内。3年前还是个卖着卤肉饭和牛肉面的小吃店，如今成为名人络绎上门的私厨餐馆。从知名作家白先勇开始留下签名在墙上，1年半内累积数十位如郭台铭、张忠谋、辜仲亮等名人们，全是大人物的亲笔机，也是唇颊留香的见证。
他从以前我做节目的时候我就认识了，他那个时候有上我们节目会做一些他自己的菜，我觉得也就是机会，时间也到了，那他有这方面的天分，真的做得非常好。
周小琴是个杭州姑娘，前夫是台湾人，早期来台湾的日子一开始只能做帮佣，直到取得身份证才开始从事最热爱的厨师工作。
在公司就是帮别人做家常菜的主厨的，那我的专业就是做江浙菜。那我想说那时候没有什么本钱，你也没办法规划做多大的餐厅，想说小吃比较简单一点，凡事都不是你想的那么简单，做起来才知道有多么困难。
周小琴直到和前夫分开才有机会开设自己的小吃店，借钱回杭州老家开店，却又是个把自己累垮的过程。
后来因为身体出状况，我甲状腺长了一颗乳突癌，因为那时候人又黑又瘦，你把这个甲状腺割掉，可能身体没办法适应，哇，我整个人是崩溃的。那我就只吃安眠药、止痛药，每天吃还是一样痛啊，眼睛横膈，眼睛酸的掉眼泪，完了，我的人生已经完了。然后我说还开店了，开什么店呢？我说这身体已经坏掉了嘛。就有一天，我就站在电话机旁边，想要打电话给我妈，突然间我就想到鸽子。
突如其来的灵感，想到用炖鸽肉来疗愈自己的身体。 周小琴的身体才逐渐慢慢好起来。
2019年开始做卤肉饭、牛肉面，我想说那时候在杭州开过了嘛，我来台湾就带了我在杭州开店存的那一点钱，80万台币。
然后可能中午虽然生意还不错，那晚上生意就基本上是没有人。然后后来就想说我妈妈做菜这么好吃，然后我会跟建议她说，就是可不可以让她做私房菜私厨，就刚好就是有客人她就真的预约了。
从小吃店变成一位难求的私厨餐厅，这其中的天时地利人和也包含着重要的贵人。
那个私房菜的广告贴在墙壁上，这有一天呢，有一位我的贵人出现了，他就走啊走啊走，看到我这边私房小菜啊，面食啊，他就进来。这进来了之后呢，他看到我们墙壁上贴着，哎，你们还有做私房菜啊，他就当下跟我女儿订了一桌12位的这个餐点，然后他就带着他的朋友来吃了。我吃完之后，他觉得很喜欢。自那个时候，那就经常把他的朋友多带来。詹董是万金集团的老板。
好，这个葱油牛舌是微辣的，大家用的葱非常的多。在江浙菜里面，其实用到葱这么明显的其实不多，这是老板的招牌菜。
美食家吴文文也是周记食铺的常客之一，经常带着爱饭团成员来享受美食。每一道菜上桌，每个人都像听到同一道军令，全部火速举起手机，手机先吃，然后才举筷子。
当时第一次来吃到他的，我就觉得哎，好像有一点点江浙料理的一种底蕴跟风味，可是又不是那么像。然后因为他用的食材等级非常的好，所以他其实他没有什么简单跟清省的菜，他把每个菜的细节跟那个饱满度都做出来，所以我觉得他在这个市场上的餐饮的辨识度是非常高的。
茭白笋、豌豆米拌面，还有呢，
最重要的是他的豌豆才是最值钱的，蚝椒跟腐皮卷。
我最喜欢牛舌，因为我觉得那个很惊艳。
荠菜春卷呢，有了荠菜的香，然后加了一点点肉末，然后它那个炸得很酥，
花雕原蹄，它的肥肉是非常软嫩，而且不会让你觉得油腻。
我对它其实很有信心哎，对于它现在会这么算是成功吗？应该说是很多人喜欢吃它做的菜，我就是一开始就是很相信这件事情。
周小琴的女儿周泽玉现在也是店内的一份子，因为私厨而发展出来的冷冻水饺就交给她。
开始就是因为我们店里就是会有一道主食嘛，然后那个主食可能会是荠菜水饺。既然有这么多客人喜欢，那就不如来做水饺。因为我妈妈其实真的就是她这根本不可能有时间的，对，所以我就帮她做。因为我们荠菜它进来是一块一块冰砖的样子，然后就是要先泡水让它解冻嘛，它就是长这样。
急性子的周小琴听着女儿优雅介绍荠菜水饺，忍不住插嘴：“
来，我来。”转卖给我。像这个菜，以前我们小时候啊，路边啊、竹园啊、菜地上面到处都是。这个我们以前是小时候是过年才吃得到的一种菜，
是
就是包成荠菜春卷啊、荠菜水饺啊。
荠菜的纤维较粗，除了剪地头，还得靠机器脱水和切碎，繁琐流程一个都马虎不得。周泽玉虽然分担工作，更心疼母亲的劳累。
我应该不会就是想要做厨师这个职业，因为看他这样我真的觉得他太辛苦了。因为他从早上6点就要起来去买菜嘛，然后再加上他的个性又是我什么都要自己做，不放心别人。
然而人生好不容易才拿回主导权的周小琴，每天工作16个小时，张罗两个餐席、4个桌菜，晚上11点直到员工们离开，他还是一刻不得闲。
我也没办法再去开第二家店，就是把这家店顾好。私房菜我也确实真的没办法去教别人，真的等到有一天我不开了，我倒想要做一间厨艺教室，把我的这些菜全部交给这些想要学的。
凭着一股对美食的热爱，把市场上逐渐失传的江浙手路菜再次发扬光大。自身的才华加上贵人运，周小琴总是心怀感激，把美食大任扛在身上，从杭州落脚台湾，人生大转弯。这个传奇女私厨继续负重前行。
惠达执行长黄仁勋相当亲民，面对粉丝要求有求必应，毫不犹豫对着镜头秀海海，也不忘分享美食。
你们大家吃过吗？这个你们吃过，一定爱来啦。一定爱来，上好食，上好食，真正上好食。
好吃到瞪大双眼，频频落打一打，在米粉真的很好吃。原来黄仁勋30号晚上选在台北古早味餐厅宴请14位科技大佬，主要是探讨 AI 发展。他一边招呼大佬们，同时和其他用餐的民众打成一片。粉丝投签名，他开起玩笑，看到小朋友在场，凑过去摸摸口袋，包了一个大红包。
那我也要。
主桌和民众拔干净，不过似乎太开心，又加上人多，黄仁勋大俩瓜细俩瓜，连招牌的皮衣都脱下，就是想和台湾民众零距离。餐后体恤媒体，在外守候多时，送大家汽水，大显身手。
你们来哦，我丢去哦，帮我丢去哦，一夜桃会弄掉。OK， 拜托哎。能救了，
似乎为了周六大巨蛋卫龙队开球做准备。
就看 ，I don't think so。我站得高，因为我是 first pitch。
一度说自己是很好的投手，他也将成为中职史上身价最高的开球嘉宾。而随着黄仁勋身价水涨船高，前广透露他在电子邮件上有独特的撰写模式，要求大家跟进内容不能超过6行，确保是最有效的沟通。TVBS 杨俊墨思纯 SN 小组台北采访报道。
This is a new age in IT because of artificial intelligence, and it's going to be a huge opportunity for Taiwan.And so my friends and I are talking about the enormous opportunities for Taiwan here. And so I'm very proud of them.
AI 浪潮席卷全球，象征着新时代来临，而该如何为台湾带来最大的效益？惠达执行长黄仁勋30号也特地在台北古早味餐厅坐东，席开7桌宴请14位科技大佬，探讨 AI 未来发展。
当然。那个 Jensen 为什么会那么重视？他为什么会讲出台湾第一？我想这个都有他的一定的道理。
这回出席的包含广达董事长林百里、华硕董事长施从堂、鸿海董事长刘扬伟以及和硕董事长童子贤等人，而大家身价不菲，光林百里身价破124亿美元，每桌加总和高达上兆亿身价。而黄仁勋为何要跟科技界14大佬拔钢筋，摊开 AI 晶片产业链就能知道。惠达完成 AI 晶片设计后，就会交由台积电制造和封测，接着交给鸿海旗下的工业富联、广达、伟创、云达、英业达、和硕来系统整合，再交给华硕等伺服器品牌，最后卖给 Google、微软、中华电信等终端客户。另外，以鼎、台达电则是负责其中的关键零组。
很多人以前喜欢讲富国群山。到底在哪里？那我们答案非常的清楚 ，AI 就是会在那个先进的这个晶片制造以外，替台湾再创造一座叫做护国群山。
这回产业大佬座位上的安排，不少都是跟竞争对手坐在同桌，像以零件大厂鸿海的刘扬伟、广达林百里、梁次正以及云达总经理坐在一块，而黄仁勋坐在正中央。另一桌是长期以主机板、笔电为对手，华硕的施从堂和回心的董座徐小安也同桌。过去明明王不见王，却为了 AI 教父齐聚一堂。TVBS 杨俊墨思纯 SN 小组台北采访报道。
鸡汤上好食。
惠达执行长黄仁勋展现吃货精神，30号又带老婆小孩造访美国千元起跳的鸡汤名店晋元，而先前去吃的汤包馆业者说黄仁勋很亲切，没架子，
完全都没有要求说要特别的位置啦，或特别的要安静的位置，完全都没有这种要求。
其实黄仁勋在来到汤包馆吃美食的时候呢，他并没有特别指定要坐哪一桌，不过在位置的选择上呢，他却是自己坐在了靠墙而且是最窄的地方，把外围区舒适的地方让给了同行友人。
AI 教父身价正式达1000亿美元，新台币约3.2兆，但依旧喜欢啪啪照。摊开美食地图，黄仁勋26号抵台就去花娘小馆报道，最爱苍蝇头。隔天27号午餐去了梨园汤包馆，28号午餐则改到富霸王猪脚，还去预展蜜饯行大采买。晚上又逛起临江街观光夜市，29号则造访王记府城肉粽，还有私厨洲际食铺，也没错过宁夏夜市。30号在朝圣川菜餐厅纪元，从中可以发现黄仁勋爱台式小吃、川菜、中式料理，而这些餐厅大多有圆桌，也可能是他带亲友聚餐考量的地方。
不太忌口，他很甚至喜欢吃甜品，他应该是不太喜欢那些奢华排场。好，他可能比较喜欢比较自在的，而且比较贴近民众的。
而关于对台 AI 投资，黄仁勋也表示会持续扩建基础建设。
We are investing in many areas here in Taiwan. We're doing AI research here.
他还透露之后可能有台北 Two 也说不定，提议教主未来动向各界关注。TVBS 新闻焦汉文、刘宇轩台北采访报道。好，辉达执行长黄仁勋的美食地图再加一，在今天中午的时候呢，是来到了知名的川菜餐厅来用餐。好多民众一看到他哦，眼睛一亮，觉得好兴奋，是不停的要跟他合照，而他也是来者不拒。那么另外呢，是面对媒体的提问，他也是有问必答。马上也听一下，稍早访问。
好假，做好假哎，
好假，
给餐做好假，
假娃子，
你假。加龟汤，
好，那么呢，可以听到黄仁勋呢，他首先是用台语来表示哦，哇，这个川菜餐厅哦，他吃到的美食啊，鸡汤真的是很好吃。而面对 AI 的议题呢，他则是用英文来做回应，是表示说呢，将会持续在台湾来做投资，而且呢，在台湾也有呢这个专业的团队在这里，在未来也会持续的扩大基础建设。而面对呢，在晚间的时候是否会跟鸿海来见一面呢？他则是打模糊仗，表示说呢晚间还没有到。而另外呢，是否会抽空回台南一趟？他则是表示说呢，这个时间啊真的是蛮紧凑的，可能哦这一次来台湾恐怕就不会到台南了。
This is really good. Yeah, it's really good.
在宁夏夜市看到鱿鱼羹、炒米粉，再看到绿豆沙牛奶，又停下来。黄仁勋带着张忠谋、林百里，人挤人试探逛夜市。
嘿，不要叫太多了，味道就好了。We have the same room for Shiva.
锁定鹅煎和豆花，大方和民众自拍。周三晚上11点多，高龄92岁的张忠谋，平常都10点半、11点睡，但人生首次夜市体验，精神很不错。对林百里来说也很新鲜。
常常来逛夜市，
好久没有。
那你就做晚还醒的是夜猫子吗？
林百里做东吃晚餐，黄仁勋当夜市导游，三巨头集合场面难得。其实黄仁勋和张忠谋交情匪浅。1995年，辉达刚成立，32岁的黄仁勋写信给张忠谋，询问可否替辉达代工晶片。张忠谋回电给他，让他激动不已。
他也到张忠谋家里面去吃饭。十几年前黄仁勋生日的时候呢，这个张淑芬啊，他还让黄仁勋挑一副黄仁勋自己喜欢的画当做他的生日礼物。
台积电不离不弃的协助对辉达影响很大。去年张忠谋获得首届李国鼎奖，黄仁勋还带夫人惊醒现身。他和张忠谋相差31岁，不只是伙伴，也是朋友。而黄仁勋和林百里也是多年合作。2016年辉达首部 AI 电脑，还有2023年最新 AI 伺服器都出自广达。黄仁勋过去参加台北国际电脑展，还特别跑到广达摊位站台。这次逛完夜市，黄仁勋贴心护送大家坐车才离开。
Good night。
被问到要去哪，黄仁勋说：“真的要睡觉了。”来台和好友见面，除了工作往来，也看出和张忠谋、林百里私下交情深厚。特别新闻王新堂、小丽人台北采访报道。
粉丝太热情，被保镖推开 ，AI 教父罕见瞪了一眼。毕竟超宠粉的黄仁勋几乎有求必应，吃晚餐也没闲下。
我抢我火力的，
光打一买通签名合照，来者不拒，不止跑出来跟粉丝见面。在餐厅内还跟民众干杯，甚至现包红包给小妹妹，就连外头的媒体也顾到。
能手啦，不要只手，能手 OK。
但今天 可不是纯吃饭，特别做东选在北市的古早味餐厅，包下七桌宴请供应链的伙伴们，点了鳕鱼、虾仁炒饭、老皮嫩肉，还有芋头米粉汤，这些都是黄仁勋爱吃的。外传总花费约32,571元，但这一晚几乎全台科技巨头都到了。
先生为什么会那么重视？他为什么会讲出台湾第一？我想这个都有他的一定的道理。
甚至鸿海董事长刘扬伟臭嗨嗨，看来对聚餐很满意。
一定会，下礼拜你就知道。
因为 AI 的这个整个产值可能会加重起来，比半导体只会大不会小。
做多的黄仁勋也大赞这些伙伴们都认识了30年了，是世界最棒 CEO， 接下来还要继续合作。
This is a new age in IT because of artificial intelligence.And it's going to be a huge opportunity for Taiwan. And so my friends and I are talking about the enormous opportunities for Taiwan here. And so I'm very proud of them.
黄仁勋来台几乎每天行程满档，吃美食也跟供应链伙伴加深情谊，让台湾有望成为 AI 大国。体育新闻，新闻向家庭 SNG 小组台北总报道。AI 教父辉达执行长黄仁勋今天晚上是再度做东，邀请业界的好友们吃饭，晚餐就选在敦化南路上的古早味怀旧餐厅，不只有鸿海董事长刘扬伟和和硕董事长童子贤，跟广达的董事长林百里，还有云达总经理杨其令。在进入餐厅吃饭之前，黄仁勋针对投资台湾也有话要说。
Always investing in Taiwan. This is one of our most important countries. And of course, this is the beginning of our company's business because we build our wafers here and build our systems here.And we also have partners that we go to market with here.
黄仁勋也说，每个国家都应该利用自己的优势，但也说今天晚上自己没有要去夜市了，请大家不要再跟着他。也说今天其实是自己做东，主要的目的还是要找自己的朋友来吃吃饭。最后听到有人帮自己吃过的餐厅建立成美食地图，也很开心。更再度预告，又在星期天晚上台大的演讲上跟大家正式见面。
给汤熊和家。
回答执行。长黄仁勋展现吃货精神，30号又带老婆小孩造访美国千元起跳的鸡汤名店晋元，而先前去吃的汤包馆业者说黄仁勋很亲切，没架子，
完全都没有要求说要特别 的位置啦，或特别的要安静的位置，完全都没有这种要求。
其实黄仁勋在来到汤包馆吃美食的时候呢，他并没有特别指定要坐哪一桌，不过在位置的选择上呢，他却是自己坐在了靠墙而且是最窄的地方，把外围区舒适的地方让给了同行友人。AI 教父身价正式达1000亿美元，新台币约3.2兆，但依旧喜欢啪啪照，摊开美食地图。黄仁勋26号抵台，就去花娘小馆报道，最爱苍蝇头。隔天27号午餐去了梨园汤包馆，28号午餐则改到富霸王猪脚，还去预展蜜饯行大采买。晚上又逛起临江街观光夜市，29号则造访王记府城肉粽，还有私厨周记食铺，也没错过宁夏夜市。30号在朝圣川菜餐厅晋元，从中可以发现黄仁勋爱台式小吃、川菜、中式料理，而这些餐厅大多有圆桌，也可能是他带亲友聚餐考量的地方。
不太忌口，他很甚至喜欢吃甜品，他应该是不太喜欢那些奢华排场，他可能比较喜欢比较自在的，而且比较贴近民众的。
而关于对台 AI 投资，黄仁勋也表示会持续扩建基础建设。
We are investing in many areas here in Taiwan. We're doing AI research here.
他还透露之后可能有台北 2也说不定。评议教主未来动向，各界关注。TVBS 新闻焦汉文、刘轩台北综合报道。好，辉达执行长黄仁勋的美食地图再加一，在今天中午的时候呢，是来到了知名的川菜餐厅来用餐。好多民众一看到他哦，眼睛一亮，觉得好兴奋，是不停的要跟他合照，而他也是来者不拒。那么另外呢，是面对媒体的提问，他也是有问必答。马上来听一下稍早访问。
哎姐，做好食诶，
好食，
鸡汤做好食诶，
食偌济，
你食
加龟汤。
好，那么呢，可以听到黄仁勋呢，他首先呢是用台语来表示哦，哇，这个川菜餐厅哦，他吃到的美食啊，鸡汤真的是很好吃。而面对 AI 的议题呢，他则是用英文来做回应，是表示说呢，将会持续在台湾来做投资，而且呢，在台湾也有呢这个专业的团队在这里，在未来也会持续的扩大基础建设。而面对呢，在晚间的时候是否会跟鸿海来见一面呢？他则是打模糊仗，表示说呢晚间还没有到。而另外呢，是否会抽空回台南一趟？他则是表示说呢，这个时间啊真的是蛮紧凑的，可能哦这一次来台湾恐怕就不会到台南了。
This is really good. Yeah, it's really good.
在宁夏夜市看到鱿鱼羹、炒米粉，再看到绿豆沙牛奶，又停下来。黄仁勋带着张忠谋、林百里，人挤人试探逛夜市。
哎，不要叫太多了，味道就好了。We have the same room for shaving.
锁定鹅煎和豆花，大方和民众自拍。周三晚上11点多，高龄92岁的张忠谋平常都10点半11点睡，但人生首次夜市体验，精神很不错，对林百里来说也很新鲜。
大家来逛夜市，
好久没有。
那你就坐我还醒的是夜猫子吗？
林百里坐东吃晚餐，黄仁勋当夜市导游，三巨头集合场面难得。其实黄仁勋和张忠谋交情匪浅，1995年辉达刚成立，32岁的黄仁勋写信给张忠谋，询问可否替辉达代工晶片。张忠谋回电给他，让他激动不已。
他也到张忠谋家里面去吃饭。10几年前黄仁勋生日的时候呢，这个张淑芬啊，他还让黄仁勋挑一副黄仁勋自己喜欢的画当作他的生日礼物。
台积电不离不弃的协助对辉达影响很大。去年张忠谋获得首届李国鼎奖，黄仁勋还带夫人金醒现身。他和张忠谋相差31岁，不只是伙伴，也是朋友。而黄仁勋和林百里也是多年合作。2016年辉达首部 AI 电脑，还有2023年最新 AI 伺服器都出自广达。黄仁勋过去参加台北国际电脑展，还特别跑到广达摊位站台。这次逛完夜市，黄仁勋贴心护送大家坐车才离开。
Good night。
被问到要去哪，黄仁勋说真的要睡觉了。来台和好友见面，除了工作往来，也看出和张忠谋、林百里私下交情深厚。台北新闻王新堂、小智人台北采访报道。
那个黑衣男辉达执行长黄仁勋29号晚上现身松山区一间私厨餐厅，同桌的还有广达董事长林百里、副董事长梁次正、台积电创办人张忠谋以及联发科董事长蔡明介、台湾大董事长蔡明宗等企业大佬。
Here, they want to see you, right here. I can see you.
黄仁勋返台一举一动备受关注，外头一样有热情粉丝等着合照签名，后头紧跟着的是他的夫人，也一起共进晚餐。据了解，这场餐叙是由广达董事长林百里做东，早在傍晚5点多，广达就已经派随扈前来敞刊，确保餐叙可以顺利进行。林百里最早现身在店内亲自招待贵宾。
晚安，晚安。
而据了解，大佬们聚餐的这间餐厅是最难订的台北三大私厨之一。这场号称是赵元宴的来宾，个个身价不凡。张忠谋身价36亿美元，林百里124亿美元 ，AI 教父黄仁勋1000亿美元，蔡明宗54亿美元，蔡明介则是38亿美元。五个人的总身价超过台币4兆元。而其实回首今年1月，张忠谋、黄仁勋、林百里三个人也曾经到这间餐厅用餐，如今再次齐聚，虽然谈什么保密到家，不过可以一睹 AI 大佬的踪影，也让不少民众好兴奋。体育新闻沈明杰台北报道。
Yes, this time we are so eagerly anticipating the establishment of the Taiwan R&D Center. As far as I know, it is the first of its kind, the first one in Asia. So would you like to share with us what are the major factors that influence your decision on choosing Taiwan as location for this very important center?
Well, we have a very long history in Taiwan. A long time ago, when I was young and Vidya was young, I came to Taiwan to seek partners to help us build our chips. And I was fortunate to have the support of TSMC,
yes.
The packaging companies here in Taiwan, SPIL, many assembly companies here, Foxconn and ASUS and MSI and Quanta and so many companies that helped us along the way. And so for over a quarter of a century now, over 25 years, wow. We've been doing...
That's a long history.
Very long history with companies in Taiwan. And so that's one reason. Another reason is the technology excellence.
The ecosystem is
unparalleled. Every aspect of building chips and building computers are located here. All the way down to the most minute, complex connectors that connect very high-speed cables are manufactured here. And so the technology is excellent. The work ethic of the people here are incredible. And the companies have a spirit of partnership.
Yes.
Has really set Taiwan apart. And so I'm a huge fan of the company, the industry here, because it goes back with us for a very long time. Mm-hmm. And that's a good foundation. But Taiwan is the source of so much of our engineering. And we have hundreds of engineers here. And over the next 5 years, we're going to hire another 1,000 engineers here. And so we're going to set up our R&D center here, a major R&D center here. Mm-hmm. We're seeking for a large plot of land so that we can build a significant headquarters here.
Okay.
And so if anybody has some property they'd like to tell me about, you know, please let me know.
NVIDIA's stock price hits its new high recently, and so has your value. What does that mean to you?
Absolutely nothing. I was trying to think of a good answer, but I still wake up the same time. I still work the same way. I ate the same things. I love all the same things. I love all the same people. Nobody treat me any different. And I still have a mountain of work in front of me. And so nothing has changed.
I think it's everybody's curiosity. We've seen you really like to visit Taiwanese night markets. Mm. What attracts your interest so much in these night markets?
People are nice. They're working so hard. And they're trying to make a living. And it's nice to support them. When I was a child, I still have memories of going to the night market. And I enjoy the night market so much that I got my face cut at the night market.
Oh yeah, you mentioned yesterday.
I have a big scar on my face because of the night market. But I always have wonderful memories of the night market, and my parents used to take us a lot, and somehow it's always had a real fond place in my heart. And of course, the green mangoes are terrific. The fruit lady's fantastic. And so, you know, everybody works so hard. Everybody's so nice. And they're trying to make a living. It's kind of nice to be there to support them.
Gladly, the good old days, not just remain in memories.
Yeah. And I get to enjoy those memories. Yeah. Yeah.
I was very surprised, you know, to see Maurice Chong visiting night markets in the late evening with you on TV. I say, hey, we hardly see him appear in public this way.
I think it was Morris's first time at the night market.
Really?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So how did you persuade him to go there?
He wanted to go. And we had oyster fried pancakes, and we had some shave ice, two great, great places. And he really enjoyed it. And mostly, we just enjoy each other's company. And I thought you did a fantastic job. That was an excellent interview. I might become a fan and watch your interviews.
Thank you so much. Thanks. Nowadays, the application of AI is reaching almost every dimension of our lives. However, human-android robot doesn't popularize now. When do you think it might become a popular product? And if it does so, how will you envision it might tremendously change our lives?
Humanoid robotics will be as common as cars are today. You got to imagine what a car looks like 100 years ago on the street. What a strange instrument going down the street by itself without a horse in front of it. And so I think 100 years from now, it's very clear we'll have humanoid robots everywhere. It will likely be the largest volume mechanical system the world makes.
Won't be another 100 years ahead, right? Won't
well,
be that long.
The beautiful thing about vision is you start from the future and then you work your way back. It's a lot easier than starting from the present and work your way forward. Because if you, it, of course, the future is easier to predict. Next week is very hard to predict. Next year is very hard to predict. But long-term is incredibly easy to predict. And so I think working our way back is easy. Now the question is, if it's clear, so mundane, so commonplace in 100 years, when would it become quite commonplace now? Well, the world needs a lot more manufacturing capability. The number of manufacturers in the world is quite low. Labor force is quite short. And as a result, we're going to continue to see inflation. There are many things that a robot can make that no humans can make or safely make. And so there are things that only robots should build. And so I think it's very clear that we need to have robotics technology. The challenge, of course, is the technology itself is incredibly hard. A robot that understands the physical world, mm-hmm. that understands the laws of physics, that when it sets this down on a table, it won't go through it, that it could set it down and leave it. It has to understand all of these common sense things that children somehow learned over the years. And so we have to teach these things to AIs.
I see.
And of course, the common sense, the ability to understand us, all of that technology is evolving very, very quickly. And I think that over the next 2 or 3 years, you're going to see quite significant breakthroughs.
I have some present for you.
Oh, my goodness.
Good food.
I have to say that your questions are thoughtful.
Wow, that relieved all my pressures all around.
It's thoughtful, and you're conversational, and I thought you did a fantastic job. That was an excellent interview. I might become a fan and watch your interviews.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I was very surprised, you know, to see Maurice Chang visiting Night Markets in the late evening with you on TV. I say, hey, we hardly see him appear in public this way.
I think it was Morris's first time at the night market.
Really?
Yeah.
So how did you persuade him to go there?
He wanted to go. And we had oyster fried pancakes, and we had some shave ice, two great places, and he really enjoyed it. And mostly, we just enjoy each other's company.
Yes, this time we are so eagerly anticipating the establishment of the Taiwan R&D Center. Mm. As far as I know, it is the first of its kind, the first one in Asia. Mm. So would you like to share with us, what are the major factors that influence your decision on choosing Taiwan as location for this very important center?
Well, we have a very long history in Taiwan. A long time ago, when I was young and Vidya was young, I came to Taiwan to seek partners to help us build our chips. Mm-hmm. And I was fortunate to have the support of TSMC,
yes.
The packaging companies here in Taiwan, SPIL, many assembly companies here, Foxconn and ASUS and MSI and Quanta, and so many companies that helped us along the way. And so for over a quarter of a century now, over 25 years, we've been doing very long history with companies in Taiwan. And so that's one reason. Another reason is the technology excellence.
The ecosystem here?
The ecosystem is unparalleled. Every aspect of building chips and building computers are located here. All the way down to the most minute complex connectors that connect very high-speed cables are manufactured here. And so the technology is excellent. The work ethic of the people here are incredible. And the companies have a spirit of partnership that has really set Taiwan apart. And so I'm a huge fan of the company, the industry here, because it goes back with us for a very long time. Mm-hmm. And that's a good foundation. But Taiwan is the source of so much of our engineering. And we have hundreds of engineers here. And over the next 5 years, we're going to hire another 1,000 engineers here. And so we're going to set up our R&D center here, a major R&D center here. Mm-hmm. We're seeking for a large plot of land so that we can build a significant headquarters here.
Okay.
And so if anybody has some property they like to tell me about, you know, please let me know.
NVIDIA's stock price hits its new high recently. and so has your value. What does that mean to you?
Absolutely nothing. I was trying to think of a good answer, but I still wake up the same time. I still work the same way. I ate the same things. I love all the same things. I love all the same people. Nobody treat me any different. And I still have a mountain of work in front of me. And so nothing has changed.
I think it's everybody's curiosity. We've seen you really like to visit Taiwanese night markets. Mm. What attracts your interest so much in these night markets?
People are nice. They're working so hard. They're trying to make a living. And it's nice to support them. When I was a child, I still have memories of going to the night market. And I enjoy the night market so much that I got my face cut at the night market.
Oh yeah, yes, you mentioned yesterday.
I have a big scar on my face because of the night market. But I always have wonderful memories of the night market. My parents used to take us a lot, and somehow it's always had a real fond place in my heart. Of course, the green mangoes are terrific. The fruit lady's fantastic. And so, you know, everybody works so hard. Everybody's so nice. And they're trying to make a living. It's kind of nice to be there to support them.
Gladly, the good old days, not just remain in memories.
Yeah. And I get to enjoy those memories. Yeah.
I was very surprised, you know, to see Maurice Chong visiting night markets in the late evening with you on TV. I say, hey, we hardly see him appear in public this way.
I think it was Morris's first time at the night market.
Really?
Yeah.
So how did you persuade him to go there?
He wanted to go. And we had oyster fried pancakes, and we had some shave ice. Two great places, and he really enjoyed it. And mostly, we just enjoy each other's company.
2024 Computex 台北国际电脑展重磅登场 ，AI 战场真的是在台湾可以看到大咖云集。我们就来看辉达执行长黄仁勋，今天呢也是行程满档，他上午跑电脑展，下午跟全球媒体对谈，直呼自己从早到下午只吃了六片饼干。同时，超微的执行长苏姿峰也到电脑展帮供应链站台。外媒指出双方在争夺人工智慧控制权，而黄仁勋则说明说苏姿峰是很棒的人，其实两人是远。但黄仁勋说跟苏姿峰其实也没这么熟，但是他以他为荣。
巨星般登场，辉达执行长黄仁勋走到哪镁光灯就在哪，电脑展来台故装，外国媒体彭博更指出 NVIDIA 和 AMD 在争夺人工智慧控制权，双方互别苗头。
We're very different people. I'm very proud of her. Well, I'm Jensen, and she's not.
台南英娜相互竞争台湾晶片市场。黄仁勋说，苏姿峰是很棒的人，不过对他不太熟悉。
I don't know her that well to be able to tell you.
Did you contact with her this time?
I haven't seen her, but I understand she's on the island, and I'm sure she's doing terrifically. I'm very proud of her. She's incredibly capable.
但共同的是，两人都要在台湾设立研发中心。黄仁勋更证实，要在台湾设立第二个 AI 超级电脑中心。在被问到敏感话题怎么看大陆市场
？China market is very important to us. We have export control compliance that we have to obey.
电脑展首日，黄仁勋行程满档，从早到下午只吃六个饼干。全球媒体对谈也吸引上百媒体到场。相较于黄仁勋高调亲民，苏姿峰则是低调，也打团体战，找四大品牌伙伴在电脑展登台演说。
This is too beautiful to eat.
前脚黄仁勋逛展，后脚苏姿峰也开逛，到云达科技摊位，人气很旺。云达还送印着 AMD 和 QCT 字样煎饼礼盒。四处到供应链站台，也与美超微执行长梁建厚见面。个性不同的黄仁勋和苏姿峰，从远亲到劲敌，这对表舅生会持续在 AI 领域亦敌亦友。TVBS 新闻廖广斌、吴俊伟、张慧仙台报道。
好，还有这位大咖是英特尔执行长基辛格，也宴请11家重量级台厂供应链。今天呢，他在 Computex 发表主题演说时，也不忘感谢台湾的合作伙伴，更用中文向观众问好。而逛起合作台厂摊位签名，他合照样样来。谈到台积电，还大赞对方很重要，双方关系合作也竞争。而对刘德英退休交棒魏哲嘉，他也大方献上祝福。
大家好，
秀中文接地气。英特尔执行长基辛格4号在 Computex 发表演说，透过影片感谢台湾合作伙伴，包含华硕董事长施崇棠、广达总经理梁次正、宏基董事长陈俊胜等人都亲自到场力挺。
Intel has had its operations in Taiwan since 1985, and next year at Computex, we're going to have a little 40-year birthday party for Intel and Taiwan.Intel and Taiwan together.
基辛格还趁势发表最新处理器 Xeon Six， 号称处理速度更快、效能更强。而提到旗舰产品 AI PC 处理器 Lunar Lake， 还特别感谢朋友台积电协助打造。另外也不忘逛起合作台厂摊位。开心极掌，基辛格来到云达展厅看供应链成果，直呼感动，留下签名。云达也回赠台式煎饼。所到之处响起热烈欢呼声。由于微影伺服器使用英特尔晶片，基辛格也用签名来按赞。而谈到台积电，基辛格态度也放软。
I'm a customer. We collaborate and we compete. So I think of the Intel relationship with TSMC as one of the most important ones for the industry. Two strong technology, you know, leaders, and we have much to learn from TSMC.
过去曾暗酸台积电，如今直言是合作兼竞争关系。
I meet regularly with CC, and really congratulate Mark on his, you know, stepping back today and giving the chairman baton to CC.
面对刘德英退休，更大方献上祝福，还透露和魏哲嘉关系密切，双方强上加强，携手继续抢食 AI 大饼。TVB 新闻高子豪、刘宇轩台北怎么导。
辉达执行长黄仁勋他提到，在台湾要设置研发中心的厂址，台北、台南跟高雄都是选项，因此下午地方首长也纷纷的端出牛肉，强调自己的优势。另外新北市长侯友宜在议会质询时也爆料，有派人主动接触，现在形成了四强争抢辉达的局面。
辉达在台湾的研发中心还没确定，不过鸿海已经先喊话要跟辉达共同建制先进的立算中心，而地点就落在高雄的软科中心。由于鸿达早在高雄软科布局已久，加上先进算力中心的设立，也让辉达研发中心落脚高雄似乎水到渠成。
还是一句话了哈，是机会是留给准备好的人。高雄投资的先进的厂商，我们都附送三个传位，三个传奇一定要写
啊！我觉得台南也是很好的，尤其台南如果在沙仑跟高雄又很接近，那是算是一个南部科学园区的一个辅轴中心。
除了高雄，台南市长黄伟哲也喊出已经找好地点，就位于高铁站旁沙仑智慧绿能科技城，但就怕兄弟阋墙，强调要跟高雄一起共荣。只是黄仁勋点名的地点还有台北
产业的转型以及教育创新。密不可分，台北市都已经准备好。
从一开始，我们就积极地去争取。我也请我们的移民局长跟辉达的总监嘛，
然后研发总监也有跟辉达那边联系过了。
就连旁边的新北市侯友宜也主动出击，端出自己的牛肉。由于高雄市将有台积电进驻，近年来还有软科及亚湾撑腰，加上有早早发展 AI 的大学及顶大即将进驻，拥有全面优势。另外台南有南科及沙仑园区相辅相成，加上地点就在高铁站旁，实力也不容小觑。而台北市本来就是国际都市，又是政经中心，人才及新创实力雄厚，就连新北市都动之以情，强调辉达三成的供应链就在新北，加上腹地可以四选一，地点也具有优势。
在高雄，它有天时地利人和的一个产业哦，对我们来讲，我是觉得在高雄是最好。
到底是卖瓜说瓜甜，还是各县市已经准备好，就等辉达最后公布答案 ？TVBS 新闻南部综合报道。
好，继续政治话题来看，国民党团总召傅昆萁今天中午席开五周宴请党籍立委，不过因为上个星期立法院长韩国瑜才刚请过，而且喊话应该先暂缓推动冲突性的法案，就被绿营解读说难道是要较劲韩国瑜吗？而对此傅昆萁强调就是定期参叙很正常。
哦，总召说今天不喝酒，
气氛和乐，有说有笑。国民党团总召傅昆萁席开五桌，找党籍立委一起吃饭，难不成需要沟通花东三法？
我想这个参叙啊是很正常的哈。那也希望大家都给国民党鼓励打气加油，好，谢谢。
是不是要多沟通花东三法的部分呢？想要参叙，老早约好，但党团大会就不少委员抱怨，国会改革才三读完，人没放松，频频假动，尤其立委赖世葆刚到时，
今天大概是总召来犒赏，不是、啊，来慰问大家吧。我刚才办公室等表决啊，我就来跟他。打个招呼，我要回去了。
想跟傅昆萁当面聊聊，但就这么刚好人一到，傅昆萁一分钟前才正好离开，那想说的只好再隔空对话。
这个案子因为已经被抹黑掉了，我们有必要对外讲清楚。听那些新科的立委，他们还要继续选好几届，这个老实讲没那么急啊。
认为不急于一时，忧心法案被贴上前坑标签已黑掉了，不能再贸然闯关。
那其实还有很多党内的议题需要多沟通哦。
这铁板得先摆平自家立委，党内或许还得再多多讨论。这一回扣掉正副院长，约有40位委员到场，但先前立法院长韩国瑜宴请蓝委，希望先暂缓推动冲突性法案。还有第二次6号韩国瑜要找司法跟卫环委员会委员吃饭聊聊。
傅昆萁总召应该放弃个人之私了哈。不要再强推这样高度争议性的法案，
民进党阵营一定会见缝插针的，好，所以我觉得我们就是坚定自己的节奏。
民进党认为两人较劲意味浓，尤其韩国瑜幕僚也加入党团群组。
院长聆听跟支持的这个角色，对于很多我们国民党的委员也是一个定心丸，
帮忙缓颊。两人角色不同，就怕被对手见缝插针。TVBS 新闻，我想林轩台北采报道。
日前在立院发生的朝野冲突，民进党立委郭国文抢夺秘书长周万来文件一事，国民党今天在大院提案要将他送纪律委员会惩处。不过郭国文反击，那国民党立委拿椅子砸人要不要送，根本是选择性的移送。而在院会处理时，民进党团提议要求交付协商。
再生医疗法制定通过。
立法院长韩国瑜敲锤一声，历经三会期十年的讨论，终于三读通过再生医疗法，出来立委开心抢打卡拍照。但接下来要处理的这一案，当事人可就心情很不愉快。
国民党党团是刻意的选择性跟报复性的移送，
就是因为先前抢夺秘书长周万来文件，国民党提案要把郭国文送纪律委员会，
先交付协商一个月后再处理表决嘛，没有关系啊，照程序走。
民进党大党鞭柯建铭将要求进复热读交付协商，看看这个会期从3月到8月，纪律委员会招委都是民进党立委担任，因此据了解，国民党团研判最多是停权处分，无法行使立委权利。但蓝绿交锋的战场在国民党团总召傅昆萁，希望7月16号前能三读通过花东三法。不过3号晚间，行政院长卓荣泰跟绿委晚宴，交通部长李孟彦就认为这欠缺专业交通评估以及严谨的财政纪律，与会立委有高度共识，会全力阻挡。
这行政院到底有没有尊重立法院？政府零出资，从头到尾，民进党讲的2兆就是诈骗。
傅昆萁大动肝火，一再解释没有2兆说法，强调会让政府零出资，用 BOT 方式，更指柯建铭曾用这来当作交换条件。
乱讲一讲，那时候是因为国会扣钱法案，我们要求协商都没有协商嘛，不要到颠倒是非。傅昆萁啊，真的做人要有基本道理。
民生法案花东三法又成蓝绿总召大战。TVBS 新闻线，我想留一下林轩台北采报道。
好，另外话题人物还要来看这位民进党政策会执行长王义川，他爆出曾经使用手机定位的年龄、性别还有足迹，被质疑政府监控人民。只是王义川事后改口说用膝盖想的，这说法真的差很多，就让民众党主席柯文哲大酸，民进党变成新的警总，还要王义川出来认罪。
现在是 PDP is watching you， 民进党随时都在看着我们。
打拼绿营变成新警总，猛攻民进党政策会执行长王义川，群众各资到底哪里来？
哎呦，叫他认罪就好了。
蓝白正在同一阵线，从国会改革法案到现在，民众党恐怕也担心再被解读当小蓝。
我不会说把这个 当作第一优先去处理的。
不认同傅昆萁喊查过去八年弊案，民众党定调不跟进，但蓝营不放弃。
当然每一个法案都有机会有共识，但是我们会排出优先顺序，会从民生法案来开始进行。
我们本持的基本态度就是就事论事。
国民党仍想再和民众党携手，不顾绿营也想要拉拢，
都不断在释放这样的善意，递出橄榄枝。所以昨天在洗钱防治法的讨论当中是非常的有效率，所以我谢谢黄珊珊委员。那昨天黄国昌总召也有来与会一起来讨论。
脸书更po合照，写到三号司法委员会审查洗钱防治法是行政院打诈司法的重要配套，和民众党立委黄珊珊充分讨论，确实成功汇聚共识，踏出好的一步。
委员会本来就会讨论事情啊，这个很正常。
说要先撤回花东三法，
如果有前提的话，就不叫诚意了嘛。
因为民进党团总召柯建铭向民众党喊话，若撤回花东三法，大家就可以坐下来谈，却被反击有前提就不够诚意，和蓝绿拉回等距，要维持民众党的主体性。TVBS 新闻梁佩还从报道。
今天是六四事件35周年，自由广场呢举办周年晚会，详细情况在记者陈婉婷。
今天是六四事件35周年，不止总统赖清德发声，国民党和民众党也发文悼念六四事件。而华人民主书院晚间6:40在中正纪念堂的自由大道举办35周年晚会，也期许中国民众能够追求民主，无所畏惧。
在六四之前的中国，刚经历过一场人类文革的浩劫，在这场浩劫之后，中国人在共产党一党专政的夹缝当中，还有一点点贴大字报的自由，还有一点点上街抗议的自由，这些自由在六四以后全部没有了，取而代之的是中国的维稳体制，到今天的网格化管理，到今天中国用它所有能用的科技监视每一个行踪，每一个人的行踪。
这次活动不但邀请六四的幸存者来分享，也在晚间8:09进行默哀仪式，借此为六四罹难者哀悼之意。而现场也有哀悼亭以及烛光牌子，也有民主市集，有公民团体在现场进行议题倡议。
惊喜现身，回答台湾分部台北办公室，黄仁勋亲切和媒体寒暄。
Last night I went to an amazing restaurant.Traditional Taiwanese restaurant, but it's very, very small, and the chef is incredible.
讲到最爱的台湾美食，黄仁勋眼睛都亮了。传统菜牛肉面，还有最爱的苍蝇头。
我今天下午去吃牛肉面，太合家。
苍蝇头。
苍蝇头最好吃的，马杀鸡没有。
脚底按。
还没有时间。Yeah, maybe. 希望。
马杀鸡也想去试试看，黄仁勋还直接化身销售员，和员工一起介绍产品，直呼员工就像他的儿子，倾吐周六就要回美国，现在人就在他们台湾分公司，也就是台北的办公室这边，要带大家来一起揭秘他们的新产品之外，我们往旁边来看，这一次都是他们最新的，而且这一台来说呢，就是这个执行长他在展场上面举出的笔记型电脑。华硕14寸笔电搭载辉的 RTX 4070，要打电玩用室内设计等软体都 OK。
这个就是这次 Jensen 在他 Keynote 上面有讲到的 Grace Superchip。
让辉达股价直冲的产品之一 Grace Hopper 超级晶片，帮助 AI 驱动，现阶段已经量产。还有达明机器人使用辉达 GPU， 增加检测品质，良率提升。身价一兆的黄仁勋，所到之处都有粉丝簇拥，身边难道没保镖吗？仔细一看，站在黄仁勋旁边，西装笔挺的外国男子，时不时注意黄仁勋状况。根据外媒报道，2023年辉达财报，个人维安费用70万美元，其中66.9万美元，也就是相当于台币2000多万，用于支付安全。辉达说，保护黄仁勋人身安全是符合股东最佳利益，有必要也需要，毕竟黄仁勋到哪里都是目光焦点。TVBS新闻网站张慧贤台报道。
好，最近几天很夯的话题就是辉达了，原因之一是因为他的执行长兼创办人黄仁勋目前正在台湾。 另一方面也是因为它的市值飙升。辉达它主要是做绘图晶片 GPU 的，它的市值在美国冲上了1兆美元，而1兆美元这个关卡呢，辉达是首家半导体公司，而目前呢，在史上也只有8家企业达标，甚至目前只有6家企业是还在兆元门槛的。哪六家？包括了苹果啊、沙烏地阿美石油公司、微软、Google 的母公司 Alphabet， 还有亚马逊。另外2家已经跌下来的呢，一个是 Facebook， 另外一个是 Tesla。 而我们提到说半导体公司的目前市值最高的就是辉达了，第二名呢是我们的护国神山台积电，不过台积电的市值是5350亿美元，换言之只有辉达的大概一半左右而已。而专家认为啊，其实辉达啊就是搭上了这一波的AI 热潮，而且它是处于一个最有利的位置，它的营收较预期是提高了50%，因此在技术性还有 AI 狂热的催化之下，它的股价才会狂飙175%。好，辉达到底多厉害呢？基本上目前哦，在 AI 的唯一运算工具就是辉达它推出的显卡了。它在2021年的时候推出了一款高阶显卡，其中哦是搭载了10496个 CUDA 核心。什么是 CUDA 呢？它的中文叫做统一计算架构，是辉达开发的。它让这个 GPU 哦可以编写程式进行多种的运算。事实上呢，这个哦要讲到2007年的时候，黄仁辉认为说啊，其实这个 GPU 不应该只是用在图形显示而已，它也能够用来做运算工具。在早期的时候呢，其实在影像的包括压缩还有解码上 ，GPU 它的速度哦就是 CPU 的5倍这么快了。而经过15年的开发，其实现在已经出现了大量的运算工具，包括用在像是 3D 建模啊、分析数据啊、还有天气模拟等等。所以现在如果你要训练这个 AI 机器人的话呢，你就要来买这个辉达的显示卡。
辉达创办人兼执行长黄仁勋傍晚现身南港展览馆电脑展，大批民众举起手机抢着和这位 AI 教父合照。黄仁勋也来者不拒，展现亲和的一面。不过这回来看展的不止他一人，还带着神秘嘉宾。黄仁勋的爸爸妈妈也现身，这也是他们首度在媒体前公开露面。两人手牵手，看得出感情相当好，和儿子一起观展。身为科技公司大厂创办人，对于现场许多科技产品都相当感兴趣。这会是他暌违多年再度回到台湾，除了公开演讲之外，也现身台大毕业典礼致辞，在台湾刮起一阵黄仁勋旋风。黄仁勋1993年创立辉达，至今已经30年。受到 AI 人工智慧迅速发展，带动辉达数据中心晶片需求激增，光是25号单日，股价就飙涨将近25%，市值超过9400亿美元。黄仁勋的身价也水涨船高，他持有3.5%的股权，目前身家相当于台币1.07兆。不管走到哪，花2000万请的保镖寸步不离。暌违多年再度回到家乡，黄仁勋一举一动都是焦点。 TVBS 新闻综合报道。
好，我们刚刚提到哦，其实辉达呢，它的股价升得很快，它今年以来呢，已经升了1.7倍，也是第8间市值破兆美元的公司。之所以它的股价一直飙哦，有两个原因。第一个呢，是它的营收，它第二季的营收呢，预估会达到110亿美元，这个数字哦，远超过分析师所预测的72亿美元。另外一个就是它现在是独占市场了，用于AI 的绘图晶片，这个 GPU 啊，都是辉达所制造的，包括了前阵子很夯的这个 ChatGPT 啊，引发了 AI 的热潮，而现在呢，也让这个 AI 相关的晶片需求量是激增的。专家就提到了，现在啊，你想要买这个 AI 的晶片，它供货紧张的程度，就跟疫情期间大家抢买卫生纸是一样的状况。不过也有人发现啊，国外的这个科技女股神啊，她已经出脱手中的辉达持股，并没有跟上这一波的涨势。但他被问到这个问题的时候，他提到说他并不觉得后悔，他认为说接下来啊，也可以再关注受惠于 AI 发展的企业，举例来说 Tesla 就是其中一个。而关心完了科技，也欢迎拿出手机扫描 QR Code 上 TVBS 新闻网，了解更多大小趋势。
想看最完整的新闻内容，记得下载 TVBS 新闻网 APP。